Patricia, you're back.
I'm back. Yes.
And you're back.
Yes.
Thanks for being with us. This is a House of Fire daily. Mm-hmm. We've been meeting out on the deck because it's such a beautiful fall.
Yes.
If they could see our deck, it is covered mm-hmm. with leaves right now
yes.
because the leaves are falling and it's beautiful out. Mm-hmm. Do you like this time
yes.
of year?
That's my favorite time of year, actually.
Why is that?
Because the weather's perfect and the colors are beautiful. And
you like color, you like falling leaves.
Well,
I don't know if I like cleaning them up all that much, but they are beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And we're teaching on the tabernacle. You got my book there. Show them what we're doing.
Yes, this is the book that we're teaching from. And you can purchase this book on our website at chrisjackson.org, spelled with a K.
You can show them that, and I'll show them this.
Okay.
We're teaching on the tabernacle. In fact, tonight... Where are we at tonight? We're so
tonight,
many places.
Yes, we're at Lakewood Church.
Not really.
Highway 413, Branson West at 7 p.m.
7 p.m. tonight
mm-hmm.
at Lakewood. We are teaching on the tabernacle,
yes.
and we're taking several weeks there just as we are here.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we've been on the Brazen Altar.
Mm-hmm.
That is right after you enter through the gate, then you come to the altar.
Mm-hmm.
And that is because it's a type of the cross. Notice you can't get... to the inner court and to the Holy Holies until you go past this particular altar. You know, there's one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ. By mediator, it means he's between us and God. And this brazen altar, this cross is between us and God. You can't get to God without visiting or going past the cross. So go there and kneel there. You bring your sacrifice. And it's a bloody thing out there. They call it a blood religion, a bloody religion, a slaughterhouse religion. Well, it's been that way all through the Old Testament. Lambs for families, lambs for individuals, lambs for the nation, lamb on the mercy seat, lamb's blood on the brazen altar. That's because our whole salvation is predicated on the shedding of blood. Hebrews 9 and verse 22, and almost all things by the law are redeemed with the shedding of blood, for without the shedding of blood there's no remission. Jesus had to die for us.
Right.
You know, there's so much we could talk about just as him being the Lamb of God. We got to get moving on because we could stall on this section, but it's very important. You know, in the Garden of Eden, there was a lamb that died for an individual. Skins for sins.
Mm-hmm.
Say that. Skins for sins. They tried to wrap themselves up with fig leaves, but just as these leaves on the ground, they don't stick around very long.
Mm-hmm.
Fig leaf religion won't do it. They made aprons. Aprons only cover the front side. I don't know about the back side.
Mm-hmm.
But the blood of Jesus, the blood of the Lamb that was slain there in the garden, covers the entire man. So there was a blood for individuals. Actually, it was a blood for a marriage because Adam and Eve both were covered
mm-hmm.
with the skins of the rams. And then it's blood for a nation because the mercy, the high priest sprinkled blood on the mercy seat on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, for the whole nation. So blood for an individual, blood for a family. You know, the blood that was on the doorposts of the house, that was for a family. On the mercy seat, that was for a nation. But then John the Baptist was standing with water up to his loins in John 1 and verse 29 and saw Jesus walking down the hill towards him and said, "Behold the Lamb of God which takes away the sin of the world." And when you get to Revelation chapter 5 verse 9, he talks about blood for an entire universe. So everything is redeemed by the blood, whether you as an individual, us as a marriage, you as a family, your nation, this entire world, or the whole universe when we get to heaven. It's the blood. Praise God. Well, today I'll show them this one today.
Okay.
Halfway up the altar, the altar's 5 cubits by 5 cubits, 3 cubits high. So this is the grate, G-R-A-T-E of brass, and it's positioned halfway. So when the lamb is laid down, he's suspended between down here and up here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's Jesus on the cross again,
mm-hmm.
halfway suspended between heaven and hell to bring redemption to us.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this altar was bottomless, we learned the other day. What mm-hmm. did that symbolize?
The lake of fire.
That's a
yes.
burning hell, and it's the law of God and the wrath of God against sin.
Mm-hmm.
Well, look at this again. This copper grate. You could call it a grill if you wanted to. The lamb laid on top of that, or the bullock, or whatever was being sacrificed, and it does not fall into the flame. I'm glad today that there is a suspension bridge. I'm glad there is a net of safety. In fact, in the King James, it's called a network of brass. And it is that grate, that network that keeps us from falling into hell. Thank God the grace of God through Jesus Christ saves us.
Amen.
Okay, well, that's enough on that. There's a lot of things I could talk about that. But after that, we move into the next article of furniture. That is the laver right here. You can see this. After the altar comes the laver. That's an interesting word, not lever, laver. It's the same word we'd get lavatory from, or to lave is to wash. So a laver is basically a wash basin, and it's a place for the priests to wash their hands and then wash their feet before they go in to the inner court to do their service before the Lord. Now, this is typological of our sanctification. If the altar right there, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. If the altar, the cross, the law of God appeased by the blood of Christ, if that symbolizes justification, then this next piece of furniture symbolizes sanctification.
Right.
Two interesting theological words. We have to be justified, but we also must be sanctified. Mm-hmm. A lot of people think, well, praise God, all you do is come and just accept Jesus, and then no matter what happens after that, you're fine. Well, justification imparts righteousness to us, but sanctification imparts holiness. When you got saved and came to the cross, when you came to the brazen altar, your sins were forgiven and you were at that moment justified before God. But you also need a second work, or you also need not a second work, but a co-equal experience, and that is sanctification. Because the blood of Jesus justifies us, but the water, the Holy Spirit, a type of the Holy Spirit, sanctifies. And we, just as the priest was cleansed every day before going into the inner court for service, you and I need to be washed by the blood of Jesus, but then cleansed by the washing of water of the Word. What would that water symbolize? Think of several things, but you got any ideas?
Well, the Holy Spirit.
Well, the Holy Spirit is fire. We saw that. Mm-hmm. And now the Holy Spirit is typified as water.
Right.
Just as our body, 70% water. We need the Holy Spirit. You can't live without water. The earth, 70% water. Mm-hmm. And so we need to come to the water of life. The Bible is called the washing of water by the Word.
Mm-hmm.
So part of this process of sanctifying is a work of the Holy Spirit. It's a work of the cross, because we just went by the brazen altar to get to the laver, but it's a work of the Word.
Mm-hmm.
And every day we go to the Word. And when you look into this basin, I think there's a third picture here. See that one?
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting. Because notice about this, it's not shallow. This is not a bird bath. The Word of God is deep, and deep sinners need a deep bathing. Well, notice this priest is washing his hands. There is also what is called the laver and its foot. So I think originally this was built to have a second basin at the bottom. We washed our hands because that's our work. Then we wash our feet because that's our walk. Both your work and your walk need to be sanctified, both hands and feet, before you enter into the courts of the Lord. John 15:3 says, in Isaiah it says, be clean ye that bear the vessels of the Lord. But in John 15:3 it says, you are clean through the word which I have spoken to you. So he's washing his hands, and the reason for that, the next piece of furniture we'll see is the table of showbread.
Mm-hmm.
Mama wants us to wash our hands before we go and sit down at the supper table.
That's right.
So that's very important. Any thoughts there? I know this is my sermon and this is new material for you, and you're learning just
this
like everybody else is.
This is new material for me. This is the first time I've went through this teaching with you, so go right ahead. I'm learning a lot.
I think we've probably gone far enough today, but everybody say laver. That is the place where we come for Bible sanctification.
Mm-hmm.
And we're clean through the Word, we're clean through the Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. we're clean through the blood of Jesus,
mm-hmm.
but we're also cleansed, and we'll talk to you about this tomorrow. That priest is looking down in that water and seeing a mirror reflection of himself.
Mm-hmm.
We are also cleansed when the Holy Spirit shows us who we are.
Right.
And it's there that we begin to examine ourselves. And then he said, let him eat that bread and drink that cup. Right. Hope you've enjoyed this and are learning a lot, because there's so much to learn.
Yes.
And if you're not getting it all, everything I've shared or am sharing is in this book. And it's a powerful book. Find it at chrisjackson.org at the bookstore tab. Okay? Tonight, very important, if you live anywhere close, get to Lakewood Church.
Yes.
By all means.
Branson West.
Hardy's stoplight, yes. And then about a quarter of a mile through Hardy's there.
Mm-hmm.
We'd love to see you.
Yes.
And if I've never met you, we want you to tell us.
Yes.
And so we can meet you and know who's watching our program.
Amen.
Okay? Chris and Trish on the deck.
Sign it off. Have a blessed day. Bye-bye.
Have a great day.